Welcome back to my Satisfactory tutorial series. Your refineries are built, your machines are running, and suddenly everything stops. Pipes backed up, production dead. Sounds familiar? In this video, I'll show you how to take control of fluids in Satisfactory, whether it's simple pipe flow or advanced balancing with VIP junctions, so your factory never jams again. To understand fluid mechanics in Satisfactory, we need to start with the basics. How does water actually flow through a pipe? Well, it's remarkably similar to real life, but with a few video game shortcuts. Two simple rules. One, fluids move from high pressure to low pressure, and two, they move from high ground to low ground. When a water extractor pushes liquid into a pipe, it starts filling the first section. You can see how full it is by this bubble indicator in the UI. As the section fills, it builds pressure. If the next segment has lower pressure, the fluid flows into it and so on until it reaches the end. In a horizontal pipe, less pressure usually means a pipe that is less full. On vertical pipes, water falls straight down first, filling the bottom segment before working its way upward. This little characteristic makes loading machines from below a bit difficult, as the water will have to reach all the machines simultaneously or none at all, so you could experience interruptions. Just like I'm interrupting this video to kindly ask you to consider subscribing to my channel and leaving a like on this video to continue receiving helpful guides just like this one. Okay, back to business. So what drives a liquid to a pipe is pressure and gravity. But what if we want liquid to flow uphill? That's where headlift comes in. Headlift is the maximum height that liquid can climb, and every fluid producing machine, like extractor, provides 10 meters of headlift. Pumps can extend that. The Mark 1 increases it to 20 meters and the Mark 2 to 50. Important note here, pumps don't stack. Only the last pump matters, since each one resets the headlift. When you hover the pump hologram over a pipe, you'll see this blue circle. It shows the maximum climb height, so it's very easy to identify. You can also check by opening the pump's UI. This dial here shows you the current headlift, and if your pipes exceed it, you'll get an error message. One key detail here, pumps only push water forward, they don't pull it from behind, so make sure liquid actually reaches your pumps in the first place. Headlift can also come from gravity. If your pipe drops from a certain height, it can climb back up the same amount without using pumps. That's why fluid storage tanks can generate headlift. But with a catch. It's variable. A full tank gives you its maximum height as headlift, but as it empties out, the headlift decreases. Headlift from gravity does stack with other types of headlift, however, pumps still reset it, so pumps have to be placed upstream for them to stack. So if you connect a vertical pipe directly to an extractor, it can climb about 10 meters with a small tolerance. Adding a Mark 1 pump raises it to 20. Now, how far does headlift transfer? The hologram makes it look like it stops after a while, and maybe it used to. Please let me know in the comments if you have any input on this, but in my recent tests, headlift actually carries through the pipe indefinitely. I built a long winding snake of pipes and an extra long straight one. In both cases, the pressure carried all the way to the end. But there's one exception. Pipes that aren't completely full. Because pipes are bidirectional, partially filled pipes can cause weird pressure variations, including fluids temporarily flowing backward, a phenomenon sometimes called slushing. To avoid this, the general rule is always keep your pipes full, or they'll behave unpredictably. Gases don't require a headlift to move upwards. This is purely a liquid requirement. So if there's something you should remember, is this. Keep your pipes full, don't feed from below, and make sure your pumps have water. Add pumps early and lift the fluid high, and gravity will do the rest. The path the pipe takes between the pump and the machines is irrelevant as long as it stays below the max headlift, but keeping it shorter is always better. Pipes have flow limits, 300 cubic meters per minute for the Mark 1 and 600 for the Mark 2. When you split one pipe into multiple outputs, the game usually tries to split the flow evenly. The same is true for merging two or more inputs, but pressure can change the rules. For example, here I've got two full buffers feeding into one pipe. Normally they split 300 to 300, but if I add a pump on one side, that input gets higher pressure, and suddenly it takes all 600 from that side while the other drops to zero. This happens due to the great pressure difference between the pump and the fluid tank, and it's a good start for a priority junction. If you want consistent control, don't rely on pressure, you can use valves to set exact limits. But it turns out they're not too good at that either. Personally, I don't use them for balancing, and I couldn't think of a case where I would want to limit flow. The most useful case I found for them is preventing backflow in a pipe without resetting the headlift. Let's step it up with some advanced designs. VIP junctions. Prioritizing one input over another can be really useful, especially when you're handling liquid byproducts. But the setup we just saw earlier can be unstable. A more reliable design is what the Satisfactory community calls a variable input priority junction, or VIP. Here's how it works. You build a straight pipe, add a junction pointing upwards, and connect your secondary input to that junction. You can stack more inputs in the same way. Thanks to the way pressure works, the system will always prioritize the lower input first, then move to the higher ones. But be careful, this works because fluids lose pressure when they're lifted into the upper pipe. If your second input is already coming from above, it'll actually have a higher pressure and the priority will flip. Overflow junctions. Another useful setup is the overflow junction. This looks like a regular junction, but one of the inputs has an inverted U-shape right after it. That bend causes the pressure to drop, so the game will prioritize the straight output first. Fluids only flow through the U-bend once the first line is backed up, perfect for handling excess production without wasting resources. And finally, the best way to feed liquids into machines, manifolds. They are just a series of junctions, and if you make sure you don't chain too many machines to exceed the pipe flow limit, they will work perfectly fine once the manifold fills up. Just remember to always have the main pipe higher than the machine input. In fact, you can absolutely do the same setup for the output as well. Here's my trick. I immediately step up the pipe to the maximum floor attachment height and feed it into a main pipe using the manifold setup. Since machines provide the necessary headlift for outputs, this setup means I almost never need to use pumps. To recap this chapter, junctions try to split water evenly between inputs and outputs, water loses pressure going up and gains pressure going down, the input with the highest pressure always takes priority, and the same is true for outputs, water will always take the easiest path first and only flow to harder routes when the others are full. So what are the most common pitfalls of pipe building? 1. Connection issues. If one pipe segment is full and the next one is empty, it usually means the connection isn't actually there. This happens a lot with blueprints. Pipes look connected but aren't. To fix this, just rebuild those pipes. 2. Headlift problems. If liquids won't climb a vertical pipe, you probably miscalculated headlift. Double check the height, move the pump slightly, and make sure liquid reaches the pump in the first place. Remember, pumps push, they don't pull, and headlift doesn't transfer to empty pipes, so make sure your line is full. 3. Production backup from byproducts. A classic example is aluminium production, when water is both an input and a byproduct. Most players, myself included, feed that water back into the system. But here's the catch, if you're not using a priority junction, your production will eventually back up. Even with one, if the non-priority line has higher pressure, say from a pump at the wrong spot, the junction can flip priorities and cause a backup. So double check your priority junctions. 4. Overusing pumps. Adding pumps just to be safe often creates problems instead of solving them. For example, it can turn an otherwise normal junction into a VIP junction unintentionally, messing with the flow. Use pumps only when they're absolutely necessary. Let's walk through some real-world fluid builds using everything we've covered so far. Cold power. Your first introduction to liquids would be water for cold generators. Pretty straightforward, no byproducts. I recommend a 2-to-5 ratio of extractors to generators. The ideal 3-to-8 ratio requires dual pipes because Mark 1 pipes can't handle the flow, so 2-to-5 keeps it simple. Here's my setup. Place two extractors facing each other, connect them to a raised pipe, and immediately benefit from the extractor's built-in 10-meter headlift. If you need more height, add a pump just after the extractors merge, then distribute the water with a manifold, leaving enough room for the cold belt. You can underclock extractors to 112.5 cubic meters per minute for a tiny power saving, but honestly, it's not a big deal. If you follow the rules so far and still see interruptions, try adding a water tower, which is a buffer tank placed at the highest point in your system. This gives you a small water reserve to smooth things out. Your next big fluid challenge is oil processing. Unlike cold power, this one produces solid byproducts, which means if you don't handle them, your entire production will eventually back up. Here's a simple setup. One oil extractor producing 120 cubic meters of crude oil, feeding three refineries that make fuel through a manifold. But here's the catch. Fuel production generates polymer resin as a byproduct, and we have to deal with it. In this build, I convert the resin into plastic using two refineries, each underclocked to 75%. That takes care of all the resin. But that's only half the story. If your plastic ever backs up, the resin backs up too, and the fuel production stalls. The fix? Always give your plastic an overflow route. I recommend sending any excess to an awesome sink. That way, even if you don't need the plastic, your fuel production keeps running smoothly. Finally, the hardest setup, aluminium. Specifically, the pure ingot and sloppy alumina alternate recipes. By far the cleanest and most efficient combo. I'm using a 3-to-3 ratio here, but since it's really a 1-to-1 relationship, you can scale it up and down as much as you like. Just make sure you provide enough water. In this build, three refineries produce alumina solution, fed both by two extractors and by the excess water from the aluminium scrap, using a manifold system. The alumina is then distributed forward the same way. The result is 1080 aluminium scrap per minute, which gets melted in 18 smelters to produce aluminium ingots. The tricky part is water as a byproduct. Aluminium scrap produces extra water, and if you don't handle it, the system stalls. The solution is to loop the water back into your alumina solution input. Use a VIP junction so the byproduct water is prioritized over fresh water. If you set it up right, your line stays balanced and production never jams. We'll try these setups in your own world, and if you need any additional information, a huge help is Megalion's PDF guide, link in the description. But also, don't hesitate to drop a comment on this video. And as always, come back for more satisfactory tips.